And joining us today on our Book Talk segment, great to welcome a man who's written a really interesting book, kind of an insight into how we have insights and creativity, really fascinating topic. It's called Seeing What Others Don't, The Remarkable Ways We Gain Insight. We're joined today by Dr. Gary Klein from out in Ohio today. And Doctor, thanks for joining us. How are you?
I'm very good, thank you. Thanks for including me in this.
Yeah, good to have a chance to chat with you, an opportunity to read through the book. And it is an interesting field that you kind of made your career in, studying just, I guess, how we make decisions and where, I guess, inspiration comes from. Before we get into the book itself, was this always kind of a specific topic that you were interested in?
I was generally interested in the strengths that people bring. There's a lot of researchers who study how people are biased, how they make mistakes, what can go wrong. Important. We need to understand that. But I didn't see too many people studying our strengths, where we come up with new ideas, how we get inspired, how we form insights, how we make tough decisions under time pressure. And so that's what I've been studying for the last few decades.
Yeah, you're a psychologist by trade, I should have mentioned at the top. So, and you have a very interesting background. I guess you were a psychologist, research psychologist in the Air Force. That must have been kind of interesting.
It was fascinating. It was a fortunate time that I was able to work in the Air Force right after 74 oil embargo. And all these pilots who were used to flying had to learn in simulators. And the question was, how do you develop expertise when you're not flying? What's the nature of expertise? And you had a real, it wasn't a theoretical issue. These pilots were going to be risking their lives. We had to make sure that the simulators had what they needed.
Yeah, that is interesting, because I guess nowadays a lot of the, you know, people learn as kids playing these video games, they have simulators that way, but back then that was a whole different way of doing that, simulating flights and all that, right?
Exactly, yes. Yeah. That wasn't to the norm.
No, not at all. But let's talk about the book called Seeing What Others Don't and How We Gain Insights. I know you give some very interesting anecdotes about things that people have heard about in the news. I know you talk about the Bernie Madoff situation, and you talk about the AIDS epidemic, how a doctor kind of put that whole thing together. Did you get to talk to, I guess, Dr. Michael Gottlieb? Is that the man that you talked to about the AIDS?
I just read articles. I interviewed a few of the people, but most of it was using secondhand reports that I was able to get from books and articles.
And basically, the premise is how did these people, something in them clicked that they would either discover something or study something, and they would find out things that, where did that come from? I guess that's the basic premise, right? How did they get that insight to begin with?
Right, and insight is an unexpected shift in the way we understand things, and people who gain the insight, all of a sudden, things make sense that didn't make sense before. But part of it is that other people who have the same information don't even notice it. They're just sort of sleepwalking. They're not aware of it. And so we could study the sleepwalkers and see where, and some of the book is about what stopped people from coming up with insights, but I was more interested in the successful ones, the ones who had either put it together or seen that it didn't fit together or noticed coincidences or things like that, and all of a sudden, as you say, it clicked. That was the aha moment for them.
Where does that, I mean, everybody's had that experience, maybe not on a level of some of the people, in the book, but, on a smaller scale, we all come up with something. Oh, there's where I remember now where I left something, or now I understand how this particular thing works. The aha moment, like you talked about. We'll talk a little bit about where you discovered that comes from.
Okay, so that's a really important issue. Insight isn't just the province of Nobel Prize winners or people like that. We all have insights, and they're not at high levels. It could be, where did I leave it, or why did I do something? And there's a sudden realization, oh, that's where it must be, or things like that. So insights are really fairly common, and maybe we don't give ourselves the credit that we deserve. And so what I did is I collected a whole series of insights, some of them famous ones like Darwin coming up with the theory of evolution or the double helix, and some of the very mundane ones, everyday insights, like where did I leave something, and then realizing where it had to be. So I collected about 120 of these, and then I sorted them, and I found that I could sort them into a few categories. And so there are different routes to the ways we get insights, and that struck me as an important development for helping us to see what we might do to get more insights and what stops us. So one of the routes is just making a connection. So there's Darwin, and he sees species differences, and he doesn't know why those differences occurred. And he reads a book by Malthus that hundreds of people have read about competition for resources. But Darwin reads it, and he says, that's the engine for evolution. That's what's driving the process. So he takes one additional fact, and it changes his whole viewpoint. So there are those kinds of connection insights. One type.
Go ahead.
But there's other types. Another type would be Harry Markopoulos, who looks at some of the official data from Bernie Madoff. And everybody had access to those data, and people were flying over themselves trying to get into Madoff's hedge fund. And Markopoulos looks at it and said, that doesn't fit. That's not a connection. This doesn't make sense. And there's something wrong here. And so 9 years before Madoff was arrested, Markopoulos was starting to try to blow the whistle on him because he knew it couldn't be legitimate. So that's a second route to forming insights.
Yeah, it's almost like somebody has to kind of kick the door open. They're the one that does it, and then everybody says, okay, that makes sense. Why didn't I think of it? But it did take one person to make that connection before the rest of us could, right?
That's what's so startling about it. Once somebody points it out, everybody else says, oh, yeah, I must have known that. Or it's not a big deal. It's pretty obvious. But it wasn't obvious until the person kicked the door open.
Is there a difference between insight and say, inspiration? I know I've talked to a lot of authors or people that write songs, and, they're inspired with an idea or a melody. Is there a difference between the two?
I think there must be a strong overlap between the two. I guess if we, if we wanted to be strict, we could tease out, subtle differences. People who have insights into the way things work, and a lot of artists and writers and songwriters, their inspiration isn't specifically about how things work. It's about how things could be reconfigured. So there's probably a small difference, but I think it's probably the same sort of process at work.
Yeah, it's interesting. I know you also talk about in the book, which I think is very important, particularly in the business world, organizations. Some do a good job, many do a bad job of kind of instilling, in their employees, if you have an idea, bring it forward. But in some ways, the organization itself kind of inhibits that, right, from their employees to come up with those insights or make it easier for them to do that.
That was one of the most discouraging parts of the book, was when I turned the focus on organizations. And many organizations say, we're about insights, and they give lip service to it. But they don't do anything about it, and they're more rooting out errors and trying to cut down on mistakes and having employees follow procedures. That's part of it. But the other part is that insights are disorganizing. And so there's almost a fundamental disconnect between employees who have insights about, here's what we should be doing, here's what we should be trying to accomplish. And that gets in the way of the organizational charts and the Gantt charts that organizations love to formulate, and it disrupts them. I mean, insights are disruptive, and as such, they're a challenge to organizations. Even when they want insights, they really don't.
No, it is. There are some companies you hear about, they do things in a more, unique way as far as putting people together in teams, and that's better conducive to ideas, and the other ones, the old-fashioned way, if you want to call it that, like you said, very structured hierarchy where people are afraid to come up with ideas, maybe, or just don't want to bother. So it's something that has to be worked on, I guess, among the business world.
Yeah, I'd like to see the business world. I mean, I know that they have marvelous ways of trying to cut down errors, like Six Sigma techniques and other methods for cutting down errors. I'd like to see them give even a part of that effort into fostering insights and listening to insights and taking them seriously.
Oh, you look at some of the greatest inventions we have today. It all came from somebody with an inspiration or an insight to say, let's try it, right? So everything comes from somewhere.
Right, but it can come from somewhere. But look at some of the organizational failures. You've got Kodak missing the boat on digital cameras.
Right.
But who invented digital cameras? It was Kodak.
Yeah.
And they decided not to push forward because they were making so much money by selling film. And you see example after example like that of organizations, even when they have the insight, they don't have the willpower to carry it through.
Yeah, same thing, I believe, with IBM with the personal computer. They said nobody's going to want to buy one to have in their house. We'll just concentrate on the business world to buy computers. And they missed the boat on that. And they're still doing well, I guess, but they missed out on a lot. So it's fascinating to look at. Well, the name of the book is called Seeing What Others Don't, The Remarkable Ways We Gain Insight. Just had a few minutes to kind of touch on it, but I know our listeners are hopefully be interested in reading it. Where can they get it, Doc? Do you have a website?
I have a website, www.insightexchange.net, or they can just order it off of Amazon.
Great. I know it just came out, and you were telling me it's already gotten great response, good reviews from the notes we've gotten. And, Doctor, I know you're from New York, just kind of reading your bio, right? So good to talk to a fellow New Yorker, even though we're both in different states now.
Right. I'm in Ohio, but right. I'm still happy when I get back to New York.
That's myself as well. Dr. Gary Klein, thanks for being with us, and please keep in touch, and I'd love to talk to you again sometime.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.